Works. Hi, I'm Ludwig. Welcome to my talk. I'm an engineer in the Future Technologies team, 2 decades of SUSE so far. My topic today is user merge and beyond, what's happening to the file system layout. So the other day I read an article that kids nowadays don't even know what a directory is. So they're used to their phones and you store a file, some image or video, whatever. You don't even know where it is. If you want to find it again, you just search for it. But for us distribution engineers, it's actually important where things are stored. So we need to know where things are, how the file system is structured. So when you start with Linux and are interested in how the operating system works, you could get told a few things. If the slide switching works. So what they tell you is configuration files end up in etc. You can store your data, or you will find data in var. You can store your own files and use a local. Probably third-party software goes into opt. And if you have files on your file server, they will be in /srv. Files needed to boot the system will be in /boot, for example, the kernel, the bootloader, also the initial RAM disk. The operating system itself is in various places. Binaries are in /bin/sbin, libraries are in /lib/lib64, and some parts, or the major part, is actually in /usr. And then you also have a few locations that are special. The memory file systems or virtual file systems, kernel interfaces like proxies, dev, or also temp when it's on tempfs. So what is it really? So if you look at a file in etc that is supposed to be a config file, for example, etc profile, it will tell you, please do not change etc profile. There are chances that your changes will be lost during system upgrade. Instead, use etc profile.local. So etc is supposed to have config files, but there's a config file that you're not supposed to edit. So it's not actually a config file. And you can find other examples. So if you look at LDSO cache, file even tells you this data is not a config file. So I think that is something that annoyed me ever since I used Linux. So my inner monk can't deal with this situation. We should do something about it finally. So what I did in this talk is look at the current situation and think of ways how we could simplify this chaos and bring some structure, and then let's see what we can do with that. So let's take a look at the installation of today. So if you install on X4, for example, a standard tumbleweed, it pretty much looks like this. I reused the colors of the previous slide. So green is the operating system, blue is config files, red are boot files, and violet is data, orange are virtual file systems. So in a classic tree, you can write everywhere, and the operating system basically does that. So it puts its files all over the place and mixes file types. As we saw previously, etc profile is not a config file. Etc LDSO cache is not a config file. And there are even worse examples like SELinux putting files in var. So same thing happens with /boot, for example. There's files that are operating system, like the kernel itself, but it installs the kernel in /boot, and the initd and the grub config or bootloader config in general are automatically generated. And then there's even another partition that is the AFI partition that is managed separately and files are copied there. As I said, the operating system is in various places and also puts files in locations that are supposed to be data, for example, user local, the root's home directory. We have stuff in var, in opt, and SRV. There are still applications that put files in SRV, even though those locations are kind of considered don't put files there. For some locations, we do have clear policies to avoid them. For some, we have even checks that prevent you from doing that. But at least third-party vendors still use that. I think the only one where really nobody puts files is /home by means of RPM. So how can we, the idea is to make it simpler, but first it gets a bit more complicated, and here came ButterFS. So with ButterFS, we suddenly had the ability to snapshot the operating system and roll back in case of trouble. So if an update goes wrong, you can go to a previous version of the operating system, including the kernel, because might be a faulty kernel update, and also the config files are snapshot with the operating system. So in case some format conversion had to happen for some config file. You can't snapshot arbitrary data. So for example, think of a Postgres database that is in var, or log files, that kind of stuff. You don't really want to roll back when you have a faulty update. You would lose all your data. So the way we do that on ButterFS is that we introduce new volumes, in that case sub-volumes, for all the locations that contain data. So use a local, the roots home, var, opt, SRV, and so on. Those separate sub-volumes won't be part of a snapshot, and some of them actually can't be snapshot because they are copy-on-write disabled, like databases have performance penalties if you put them on a copy-on-write file system, so it's actually disabled, so you can't even snapshot var. Anyway, the goal was to make this more simple, and the first simplification that happened even recently was the user merge. So instead of having the operating system read-only files all over the place, we put them all in /usr and give up on this arbitrary split. The reason why the operating system originally was in slash was that there was no initial RAM disk, and the kernel just mounted this basic root file system, and they needed all the tools to be able to mount all the rest. That concept didn't work anymore anyway, because latest with systemd stuff is in /usr, so you need that mounted to even boot your system. So having /bin and sbin as separate locations is just a legacy concept. And in fact, Fedora gave that up already 9 years ago, I think, and did the user merge. So all the files that were previously in sbin, bin, lib, and lib64 are now in their counterparts in /usr. And the previous locations continue to exist as symlink in slash. So you can still access the old locations. Okay, but the exercise was to make this simpler. And one thing that is kind of obvious, at least to me, is that we moved all the operating system into /user except for one bit, and that's the kernel. It still lives in /boot. So let's change that. So we can also put the kernel along with all the other operating system files. The most obvious location, I think, is with its modules. So it would be in user lib modules. That means /boot doesn't contain any files anymore that are installed directly by RPM. That would mean we could even put it on a separate volume again, like it was done in previous times. So it wouldn't be part of a snapshot anymore. Kernel initd would have to be copied there, and also the bootloader config. This setup also means that the boot partition would be no longer encrypted, because as a further optimization, we could just give up on this separate Linux file system and just use the AFI partition, and that for sure can't be encrypted because the firmware needs to access it. That makes it much more simpler though, and we could even, in theory, not mount the boot partition. Only if we actually need to update the bootloader or install a new kernel, we could mount the boot partition. So what else can we optimize here? There's still etc, the initial example. And maybe we could just separate that and say etc is config only, and the operating system stays in /usr. No more RPMs installing files into etc. That would mean we could mount the complete operating system as one thing into /usr. That enables use cases like the one Torsten explained yesterday with the image-based updater, where all the operating system is just mounted from a read-only image. All the rest has to be populated via different means. That would also mean, however, that we can't have a single snapshot anymore for the config files and the operating system. Those have to be two separate things, that are related but not tightly coupled. So that looks pretty good already, right? The only thing that is still a bit complicated here is the lots of violet. And if you think about it, like really, what's the difference between opt and user local? It's for your own stuff. So in theory, there shouldn't be a reason to have separate subvolumes for that, right? And in the end, what's in root home is similar to what is in a in slash home. And what's in SRV could just as well be in var. In fact, I think Fedora puts, for example, Apache files in var and not in slash SRV. So why keep all those separate subvolumes? That's something that bothered me, especially with those things. I use a Raspberry Pi for controlling my central heating. And on that system, there are no users. There is no files that it has to serve via web server, FTP or whatever. There's no extra software I put on. So all those subvolumes are empty, just mounted for no good reason. So by default, that system could just have var and that's it. So let's put all data in a data partition. So we get rid of all those unused subvolumes. That would make the system quite simple. It only needs four volumes that have a specific purpose. So etc is for, clearly for config files, is mostly read from, sometimes written if you need to reconfigure your system, which hopefully doesn't happen too often. Then you have the boot files. This is also mostly read-only, only if you actually update the operating system or the bootloader, you need to write to that. Then you have the operating system, also mostly read-only. Only if you apply updates, then you have to make it writable or change, actually physically change the volume. And this one has to be snapshotable. And you have a data partition, or volume, data volume. That one is written and read from. So just because we put everything on one single data partition doesn't mean that an admin who has a specific workload can't do it differently. I would just propose to, on a system like this, just put everything on one single data partition. And if an admin needs to put huge files in SRV, then okay, it's fine to mount a separate volume there. So as a result, if you do this layout, we have a clear separation of configuration files, data, and the operating systems. We have volumes according to usage. So those volumes could either be BUTFS subvolumes or actual partitions or physical hard disks. With that, we can and have to snapshot configs independent of the operating systems or use different mechanisms to manage the configs and the operating system. For MicroS, this concept has the advantage that you don't need this overlay FS in etc anymore because packages just don't write there. So with the same, if we adjust all our packages with the same technology, we can create traditional systems. Nothing would change for your tumbleweed, basically. We can run them in transactional mode, like in MicroS, and we can also do image-based updaters like the one Torsten proposed. And also, if RPMs don't write into etc anymore in some PostScript, we can have stateless systems because there will be a mechanism to just populate etc and also var on first boot. So you could erase that or even put it on tempfs, which might be useful for systems that you just plug in your network and if they power down, they forget everything. And the next pop, they are reconfigured. Okay, so let's go through the different steps one by one to check how far we are or what we need to do. First one is user merge. That one is done. So it's in Tumbleweed since May this year. The file system package actually does this conversion live in its prescript. Thanks to the rename R2 syscall that I didn't know before, it's actually possible to replace two objects in the file system with each other. It means also you can replace directories with symlinks, and that's atomic. The mechanism relies on libzip to install each RPM one by one, though. So that might be something to take into consideration for future update scenarios, because the conversion replaces slash lib, for example, with a symlink to user lib, in a transaction, RPM doesn't know about that. So if we upgrade glibc, it wouldn't know that the files in /lib and userlib are actually the same. So when glibc, the old one gets uninstalled in lib and the new one installed in userlib, RPM would delete the file in /lib, which is now the one in userlib, and you don't have a glibc anymore. Just a note for those who work on update cases in the future. Lib and bin stay, as I said, because they are ABI, so bin sh will be there forever. We have to keep the symlink. And same for /lib, because that's in ELF binaries. If you have packages that need to work on old distributions or need to be backported to lib, you can check for the SUSE version. Tumbleweed is user merged. There's no way back. So you can just assume that older versions don't have it and newer ones have it. So regarding boot, that is work in progress. The kernel just recently moved to userlib modules. And thanks to the kernel guys, by the way, for your patience. That took quite some trial and error back and forth to get that done. Right now is an interim situation, in my opinion. So the kernel PostScript still installs something in boot. So it creates the symlink to the actual kernel location in case boot is on the same volume as /usr. If you have boot on a separate partition, it would create a symlink, it would create a copy. So all other tools that look into /boot to figure out the list of installed kernels still work. But in my opinion, that is just a temporary workaround. For the future, I think we should switch to something like kernel install from systemd. That is not rocket science. It's just a shell script that starts other shell scripts in userlib kernel install.d. So for that, we can put some scripts that do what the PostScript does right now and also integrate with grub to create a bootloader entry or integrate other bootloaders. So right now, everything is kind of geared towards grub. And it's hard to replace it with something else. But if we make it flexible like this, we have the chance to, for example, use systemd boot, which is much simpler than grub. And if the kernel is not on an encrypted partition, we also don't need all those rich features of grub anymore to read LVM or to decrypt it. So a simpler bootloader has the chance to boot faster. And in my opinion, maybe it's also worth a try to use the mechanisms of the firmware of the Raspberry Pi to even boot faster in those special situations. So right now what annoys me there is that it takes like 2 seconds for uboot to finish because it needs to probe the USB ports. And then it has to load grub, which also waits by default. And then it finally loads the kernel. So there's really a lot of indirections. So I think with this model to switch to kernel install, we could have the chance to switch to other bootloaders. Having boot on a separate partition, especially a simple one like the EFI one, which is FAT, has challenges though. That is snapshot and rollback. So somehow the bootloader needs to know that the kernel you selected there, the entry there, is the right one to start with the operating system. Because if the operating system is somehow an older version, it would have also older modules, and then the kernel wouldn't really, or the system wouldn't really boot. So somehow we need to have a mechanism that makes sure that the bootloader entries match the operating system you want to boot. And on top of that, the bootloader entries don't just depend on configs and the operating system, but also the init.d might be recreated anytime without any config or operating system changes. You can just type mk init.d. So then the question is, do we need to create a new snapshot or a new entry in the bootloader or not? Those are issues that have to be thought about and solved. So next optimization was use user exclusively, so stay out of etc. That means packages like aabase can't install etc profile anymore because that is not something the admin is supposed to change. So it has to go elsewhere, means /user, or use built-in defaults. That would be the preference in case of config files. If you really have config files that can be overwritten by the admin, the recommendation would be to use user etc, because user etc is discoverable. So if the admin wants to know what configs can be changed, you look into user etc. That is much simpler than looking into user lib. So if you look at user lib, you won't see temp files as something that you can put in etc, right? So that is actually quite a smart solution. Another way would be to use systemd temp files and put your configs in user share factory etc. Then systemd would copy them on first boot to etc. But I think that is just a hack for programs that are really hard to patch. I would not recommend doing that and prefer to find other ways to do that. Also, a severe implication is that scriptlets can't modify etc in var anymore. So you can't just have a PostScript that moves your config files around or migrate your data in var. I mean, in var is already kind of broken because the transactional mode doesn't even mount var completely. So packages came up with ad hoc methods to do that. I think we need a mechanism to make this in a generic way. And I thought of some kind of migrations. For example, web application as a SQL database has migrations. So when you upgrade to a new version, it knows how to change your schema to this new version. And if you go back, ideally, it also knows how to migrate your data back to the old schema. Something similar on operating system level would be nice. So packages drop some migration scripts or whatever the mechanism will be somewhere, and the operating system knows when I have a new version booted, then I need to call this on first boot or something like that. Other mechanisms exist today, like systemd sysusers instead of calling user add. So systemd sysusers can know that it can't create their user right now and do it on first boot. What you also can't do anymore if the operating system is in /user exclusively is update alternatives. So if you mount the operating system from /usr, you can't even call bin sh because that is a symlink to etc, which is empty. And you don't even know that it should be a symlink to etc because all the information is in the PostScript of packages. There's update alternatives doesn't have a central config that tells you where things are, but rather puts it in var when you call it. So that should be replaced. One way is the lib alternatives from Adam. Makes sense for things like Node.js. I don't think it makes too much sense for bin.sh or org or whatever. I think for that we should just give up on this alternatives mechanism and use packages instead that conflict with each other. Because realistically, in the operating systems that we ship, we won't ship an alternative bin.sh, right? Also, what won't work anymore is the permissions system, at least not the way it does currently. So you could put a file in etc that says, okay, I want bin ping to be set UID root, and then it changes the permissions. But if that is on /usr and read-only, that won't work anymore. I don't know if there's a solution to that, or we should just give up on it, ship stuff like it is, or not have any set UID binaries at all anymore. That would be my preference. So next thing, data, different kinds of data. In var, that is something I didn't think about too much yet, but maybe worth for the future. So I think var is also a mess, even without putting all the other things in there. We have at least primary and secondary data. So primary data is something that you create, like your image you store, the database from your web application. And secondary data is caches. So we already have var cache, but there's also var lib, and that contains all kinds of things. And data can be also from the operating system itself. So stuff that is really coupled to /user and could be also from an app. So that's something we need to think about maybe and see how we can structure var better. Further considerations for the whole thing would be the bootloader specification from systemd. I think that is a quite nice way to place things in the boot partition without having a big config file like the one from grub. So the bootloader can discover the entries that are there. Also very interesting is the discoverable partition specification. That one is written for GPT system, so it assumes that those different volumes we talked about are actual partitions. And it enables the operating system to discover its bits automatically. So without hard coding anything in the fstab, I think we should stay out of the fstab. This is etc admin space, not for us as operating system to pre-fill. So, but since we use butterfs, we need to think how to structure our butterfs volumes in a way that they can be auto-discovered. Especially with snapshots and rollback, there needs to be a way to to flag the current to be used volume and the one that you want to go back somehow. And the mechanism with this default sub volume doesn't work anymore because we now have the sub volumes for etc and the one for user. So the default sub volume doesn't serve as a trigger for rollback anymore. And another thing we should consider is file triggers. I think we should really switch to more file triggers instead of calling scripts in RPMs. We make the system figure it out itself. So for example, in the kernel case, RPM should have a trigger that knows if you install a file called vm-linux in userlib modules, then I need to call this kernel install script. Or if it put libraries in userlib, it calls ldconfig whenever it's applicable. Less scripting makes more robust packages because packages don't have to care about that. That's pretty annoying to put those scripts all over the place. Let's get rid of that. In summary, we need a strict separation of configuration, data, and operating system. We can use the existing technologies or RPMs to build modern systems for different use cases like the transactional mode, image-based installation, but also to just keep doing what we're doing. So you can still keep your existing Tumbleweed installation with everything read-write with the same technology. We don't need a separate format or anything. Works all with the same packages, and you can also use them for containers. There's a very nice thing about the way we do that. Some of those may be invasive changes, but it's an iterative approach, so we don't need to do all of that at once. We can do it step by step, like right now we did the user merge. We are cleaning out etc and think about boot. That's some things we can do individually, separated, one after another. We don't have to do all at once. So that's it basically from my side. That means open for questions. Someone?
Yeah, thanks for chat. The tour. Yeah, there was quite a lively discussion in the chat. We still have time. There was a question from Hannes when you were talking about moving the kernel image to the userlib, I guess, but maybe Hannes wants to clarify his question now. Like, he was asking why don't we do it now already, but Hannes, can you clarify your question, or was it answered meanwhile?
Right. So, the problem is that when we're moving everything to user, the root file system itself becomes basically empty. Sadly, the root file system is the only thing which is mounted by the kernel.
Yep.
So, and the kernel requires to have something called slash init in the root file system, because that's the program which is being called by the kernel, full stop. This cannot be changed without having major surgery. Not so much major surgery in the kernel, but it's getting really, really difficult.
Yeah, I mean, nowadays, the kernel mount slash, yes, can do it, but so, we also have an initial RAM disk, so, and the initial RAM disk can mount whatever.
Yes, can mount whatever. So, but the problem is that during booting in the initial RAM disk, the only thing which you can rely on being present is the root file system. Nothing else is required to be there. This is particularly true if you have more than one hard drive. So you can be guaranteed that the hard drive you booted from is present and can be accessible, but you cannot guarantee that anything else, like the other hard drive, is actually present. There's no need for the OS even to, for the BIOS even to enable it.
Yeah, but then the kernel and the code in the initRD need to do that. So the volume that contains the operating system needs to be somehow available to the initial RAM disk.
It doesn't do it. The initRD waits for a root file system to appear. If the root file system is present, it continues, full stop.
That depends on the code that you put in there. So, I mean, yeah, already today, if you have slash user on a separate partition, which is possible,
separate partition, the initial RAM disk, because it's the same device. I'm talking about devices. you need to activate the devices. You need to wait for the devices to be present.
Yeah.
If you don't do this, your boot will fail. We've run into this time and time again because of Yast being too stupid and actually put things on different devices. And this is precisely the problem we are running into with the KDump initRD. Because Draco does not wait for more than one device. Talk to Petr Tesařek about all the steps he had to do just to get this bloody KDump initRD to work, because that needs to wait for two devices.
So, I mean, it can be fixed, I hope, right? I mean, the initial RAM disk is basically a complete embedded Linux system with systemd in it. So, yeah, it should make sure that everything you need is there.
Yeah, but currently it doesn't. So, that is a plus. The question is whether it's really needed to actually have an on two distinct devices, because I still think that's pretty much pointless. So, hence, I would just recommend to say, Radicate, please ensure that everything is installed on the same disk.
No, not necessarily, actually, because, for example, if I look at this guy, mm-hmm. it could even put the stuff that is ETC on the SD card where it boots from, and put the operating system on a separate physical thing that could be completely read-only. So an upgrade could even mean that I take the stick and put another
ETC
stick in.
That would work. ETC is a different story. I'm not talking about ETC. I'm talking about...
In this model that I explained, ETC and slash would be the same. Same volume, basically.
Yeah. So,
if you put ETC separately from slash, I mean, then good luck with that. I think the model that also Thorsten picked for his image-based installation with slash and etc on the same volume is the one that works.
Yeah, sure. All I'm saying is that we should take care of that one. And the other problem is that what I perfectly like to have essentially get rid of slash boot, because that's, well, we don't actually need it for anything. What we really need is the actual boot partition slash EFI or what you call it, depending on your system of choice.
Exactly. But
the problem is that Yast reserves not enough space in the EFI partition. There's just enough space in there to install grub itself, not the kernel and not the initRD. Which means that coming to your system, we run into this scenario that the BIOS not only needs to look for slash, but also slash user. This is where the problem will start. Hence, again, do not install on two distinct devices. That's bloody daft.
Yeah, I mean, clearly, but if we put the kernel in the AFI partition, then the AFI partition needs to be big enough to hold several of them, not just one, but several, including several initial RAM disks.
The problem is you need to instruct grub to check for both devices, slash and user, because you just put the kernel in user.
Yeah, but it needs to be copied to the AFI partition. If you depends on your bootloader. But the assumption would be that we have stupid bootloaders, not grub.
Yeah.
And then you copy the kernel into the AFI partition and the initRD, and they can then look for the rest.
Yes.
So the bootloader can be simple, and you don't need to re-implement butterfs in a bootloader.
No, of course, yeah. I'm fully with you. But then again, sadly, the EFI partition, which we create per default, is not large enough to hold more than one image. And that's something
sure.
I really, really, really would like to change.
I'm sure it's just an option in the config XML. So talk to your favorite release manager. It's already fixed today, I think. Just a matter of changing the value, yeah.
Okay, if you say so.
I'm afraid this is not as easy as you imagine, because on many systems, we do create the EFI. Well, there are other systems where the EFI partition is be created by the vendor, and while it is always possible to change the size somehow, it may not be easy. In some cases, you have to make sure that you do not, if you recreate the partitions, there are some reserved areas, and not all of them are properly marked, and if you happen to override them, then you break your device.
Okay. Bad luck. Let's get the kernel smaller then.
Okay, so there was another question, I think, related to how actually is the, or the subtrees of slash user, how are they snapshotted? If, because I think Lastimil was confused whether if you move modules under the slash user, if it makes them snapshotted or not snapshotted.
I don't know if I understand it, but all of user would be snapshotted, like with, if it's on Butterfs, we can just use Butterfs snapshots just like we do right now with the root file system. I mean, an interesting problem would be if you install additional kernel modules, like if slash user is really read-only, then you can't add third-party modules outside of package management. So then we need a different location to put them somewhere, and those modules would be data, basically. So they would have to be in var, I guess, because they're not config files. But that is something I didn't look into yet at all. I think we have the same problem on micro S already to some extent.
Okay, then I think there was a remark that that sometimes you may run into issues between the kernel and modules being of different versions, but you also said that it's a problem in your slides. As I understand, if you have both the kernel image and the modules in the same snapshot or snapshotted like synchronously, is it?
I mean, it could get inconsistent if the kernel in slash boot or in the AFI partition does not match the one in the operating system. So that's something that we somehow need to figure out, that the entry knows which snapshots of the operating system can be booted with that one. That is what comment refers to.
Yeah, then perhaps I have a question then. If you need some modules that are needed to mount the slash user, so these modules should be also installed in the boot partition.
That would be in the initial RAM disk, yeah. So the initial RAM disk is basically a small embedded Linux distribution, coincidentally constructed out of the target distribution. And that distribution has to be able to mount all the rest. That is what the initial RAM disk is for. So yeah, if you need kernel modules or network access or whatever, all of that has to be in the initial RAM disk.
Okay. Then there was another question from Phoenix. Who was confused whether slash etc is writable or not, because somehow it doesn't match his understanding of everything being read-only.
So far, I think it's read-write, but in theory, no software should write to etc, at least not during normal operation. So in theory, it should be possible to make that one also read-only and only switch it to read-write if needed. But if the operating system and user gets changed atomically, like with an image, then the only time you need to write to etc would be either when you reconfigure, like with salt or whatever, or on the first boot. And then we could use a mechanism similar to now with SED Linux relabeling. You have the snapshot or the volume read-write, do your changes, and then put it read-only again and create a snapshot in between. But yeah, the goal should be that etc is also read only during normal operation, in my opinion. Yeah.
Okay, thanks. And then there was just, I think, a remark from Kulo that when you mentioned that slash bin slash sh doesn't need to be replaced. So he said that in some products it's actually different shell. I understood.
Yeah, but I don't think it needs to be a runtime switchable by the admin. So I would assume that you decide that you want to have bin sh, for example, to be busybox or ash or whatever. Then you could install a package that is called bash.sh or bash busybox.sh or ash-sh. Complicated. And then those SH alternatives could just conflict with each other. So you decide when you create the product or when you install the system, what should be bin sh. There doesn't have to be a command where you change that at runtime. So in a system that we would deliver to our customers, like Slash base system would most likely have a pattern that says the Slash base system needs to have bin sh as bash because that's what we tested with. And org needs to be gorg, not morg or whatever, because that's what we know works. But that still enables us to have a pattern that says, okay, this is our container base image, for example, and the container base image wants to have bin sh as busybox. But then you can't replace it with bash that easily because that would conflict, of course.
Okay, thank you.